Grade 12, pre-calculus. I think this is like day 21. Yep, day 21. And we never did get around to doing the trig. All right, we had so much fun with the logs that we did lots of log work there. We actually explained what a logarithm was, because I didn't want you going away on spring break with an idle mind. The logarithms take a bit of thinking. Mind you, so do radians, right? Well, we actually did that, didn't we? Right, so it's the trig we didn't do. But tomorrow for sure. Alright, so we did a warm-up, which actually turned out to be a quiz. Right? Turns out I said this is your warm-up, well it was your quiz. Alright, so solve that. So if you know how to solve a very simple, this is one of the secrets of math. If you don't understand how to do, well, it's a secret to life. If you don't understand how to do something, turn it into something you do know how to solve, and then chances are it's the same steps to fix it up. Right? It's just like life. So over here you take away one off both sides. Over here you take away one. Look, there's no difference, right? The only difference here is you got two x's, and here you got two sine thetas, right? X's, thetas, whatever. There's an unknown thing here and an unknown, same thing. So take away one, all right? So on, let's see, so that gives us two sine thetas equals two. Over here, you'd end up with two x's equals two. Big diff, right? Then here you're going to divide by two, over here, divide by two, the same steps. So you end up with the sine of the angle is one. So over here, you end up with x equals 1. What's the difference? The only extra step here is you unsign. So if you unsign both sides, you end up with the angle. And if you unsign a 1, you'll find out the answer is 90. There you go. And if you know how to graph, that's kind of handy too, because if you were to graph this equation, you'd see it looks like this. It's got a median of 1. It goes 2 above, 2 below, 2 above, 2 below. It reaches a peak at 3. So when does it equal 3? Well, it reaches a peak at 3. Which means it's 90. So it turns out there's only one answer. Well, except for that answer and that answer and that answer and that answer and that answer. But we tend to keep our answers to the first quadrant. We don't tend to go around and around and around forever. Right? So it turns out the answer to that entire frickin' problem. Usually you get two answers. But in this case, it was one answer because it was right at the peak. Huh, all right, so that was complicated. All right, let's try this one. 2 times the sine of an angle equals 4. Well, let's divide both sides by 2. Divide both sides by 2. Survey says, so that leaves you with the sine of the angle is equal to 2. And you put that in your calculator. The inverse sine of 2 is, error. Turns out there is no such angle. How can you get to 2? I thought sine only went up to 1. Sine is how high you are on a unit circle. So if sine is how high you are in a unit circle, tell me when you get up to 2. Because you only go up as high as 1, and then you start coming down again. So how did you get to 2? Well, you didn't get to 2. That's because there is no answer. I did that on purpose, sort of. So let's do this one. You're going to divide both sides by 3. Yep, pretty straightforward. Then you're going to unsign. So you're going to unsign the two angles. The 2 theta is going to be 1/3. So when you unsign it, you get the double the angle is the inverse sine of 1/3. And what is the inverse sine of 1/3? If you're a third of the way up a Ferris wheel, well, let's get the calculator to tell us. It's 19.4. So 2 times the angle is 19.4, which means that one of the angle must be half of that. So I'm going to call that 9.7. All right. And how did I know that the inverse sine of 1/3 is about 20? Well, look at this. I'll just draw it. Right. There. I'm a third of the way up. If I went like that, I would be a third of the way up the Ferris wheel. Right there. And doesn't that look to you like it's a little bit less than 30, maybe 20 degrees? Oh my goodness, you can almost see the answer in your head. The answer was 20. Goodness sake. However, don't forget, the stupid calculator only knows the principal values. There's another spot on this place, on that quadrant, where you're halfway above. So on this side, you're halfway above, a third of the way, rather. So on this side, you're a third of the way above. So that's going to be the same angle, but it's going to be on the 180 degree side. So you got to subtract the 19.4 from that. So it's 19.4 above the 180. So it's really 160.6 because we always measure from the positive x-axis. So it turns out there's that answer. And if you have it, there's that answer. And then, of course, you should always check your answer. I had one of you take 80.3 and plug it into there. So you went 2 times 80.3 times the sine, and then you did that, not times the sine, you took the sine of 160.6, then you tripled it, and then you found out it was the same as 1. It turns out the answer checked. All right, we checked it, we checked both of them. That answer works, and that answer works. Isn't that amazing? So, do you agree? It's really pretty simple algebra. The only extra step is this unsigning, and then realizing, of course, that you get two answers. Getting two answers is sort of a different concept. So it's twice the work, but only one extra step. Okay, let's do some exponential equations. Solve the exponential equation. All right, you need the same base. So I can make fours into a bunch of twos, so I'm going to call it 2 squared. And I'm going to do a little bit of fancy power law exponent stuff there. So that'll be 2x times 2 negative 2s. So 2x less 4 is 2 to the 4th. Good. The bases are the same, so you just thank them very much. You say, gentlemen, you've done your duty. Go away. So the bases disappear. So that can only be true if the exponents are the same, which means that 2x less 4 has to be equal to 4, which means that 2x has to equal to 8, divided by 2x equals 8 over 2, which is 4. The answer is 4. Check your answer. Is 2 raised to the 4 less 2 equal to 2 to the 4th? Let's have a look. It is, right? 4 raised to the 2 is 16, and 2 raised to the 4 is 16. Oh, that's kind of neat, eh? Wow. All right, next slide. All right, oh, Wade had a good way of doing this one. So you need the same base. So let's do everything in threes. Let's say that 9 is 3 squared. And then let's say that this is 3 to the negative 2, because you got a law that says that b to the negative m is 1 over b to the positive m. So now you got the same base. You just tell them they're nice fellows, but we don't need you anymore. You're laid off. Go home. And it turns out that means the exponents have to be equal, because you don't need the bases anymore. X equals negative 1. There you go. I like the way Wade did it. He said that this was really 3 to the 2 to the x. Right? Somebody else did it this way. Equals 9 to the negative 1. Right? So that really means it's 9 to the x equals 9 to the 1. And the only way that can be, 9 to the negative 1. So he used a base of 9. So it turns out the only way that can be true is if x equals negative 1. So the same answer. Same steps, different approach. All right. What the hell were we doing there? Let's see. I don't remember what we were doing here. So I'll accelerate through it. Oh, yeah. So I was just showing you how I got that. Next slide. All right. Let's do this one that I did. It's in base 10s. You're going to like base 10 soon, because the button on your calculator does base 10s. All right, so 1 over 10 squared is really 10 to the negative 2 times x. All right, do the power law there for exponents. So this is going to be negative 2x. Same bases, toss them away. Say thank you very much, gentlemen. You're dismissed. I'll just play with my exponents now. All right, so now you're down to grade 9 math. So you got 4 less x equals negative 2 x's. I'm going to add x to both sides. So 4 is equal to negative 1 x. I'm going to multiply both sides by negative 1 or divide by negative 1, whatever. Boom, x is negative 4. All right, so that was easy enough. Next slide. We never did do that. That would be pretty easy, though. 2 raised to the x minus 3. Yeah, we'll worry about that some other time. So that was your quiz. There, if you were there, you got 100%. If you weren't there, well, what can I tell you? You knew there was a quiz. All right, let's watch our coffee cool. All right, so let's watch our coffee cool. So using the graph, because a graph is a really good way to solve things, right, and to evaluate things. So a graph is a good way to find out what's happening. A graph is a picture of an equation, so it's really just using an equation. So using the graph, what's the approximate temperature when time is 10 minutes? So here's your time. So 10 minutes, you go up to the curve and then go across. So let's see, at 10, you get a 30. So that would be the point 10, 30. So a temperature of 10 degrees Celsius gives you 30 degrees. Amazing, eh? 10, 30. A x of 10, a t of 10 gets you a temperature of 30. There you go. So when you do that, that's called evaluating. All right. Now let's do it the other way around. Now I'm saying, so what is the time if your coffee is at 50. So if your coffee's cooling and it gets down to 50, what is the time? So what is the time when your coffee's at 50? That's asking the question backwards. That's manipulating the question backwards. You probably need some algebra to do that. All right, let's have a look. So it's going to be what? Well, you just drop your line straight down, and it turns out that's at the 0.5 comma 50. So after 5 minutes, your coffee's at 50 degrees. When you do that, that's called solving. All right, when you're told the answer and you're asked what did you need to get that answer, that's called solving. So when does it look like the coffee's going to get down to 15 degrees? Let's have a look. Well, there's 15 straight across there horizontally. It doesn't look like the coffee ever gets there, doesn't it? It gets mighty close. It looks like it might take forever or infinity until it gets down to 15. That's called asymptotic. In any event, it doesn't ever quite get there until infinity, which is quite a while, by the way. I wouldn't wait. All right, so let's use equations to do that now. We did it with the graph, so let's do an equation. So what's your? Here's the equation. Your temperature of your coffee is 80 times 0.85 raised to the T, and then add 15. So plug in 5 into there, right? Plug a 5 in, see what it tells us. 80 times 0.85 raised to the 5, that's all you're doing. Wherever you see a T, you're plugging in 5 minutes, and then you add 15. The computer says 50.5. Well, that's not bad, considering that we calculated it was going to be 50. So even using a big fat pencil and dotted lines, we figured out it was 50. All right, let's calculate it for time t, when time is 10 minutes. So the temperature at 10 minutes. So the temperature at 10 minutes, well, you'll plug in a 10. And the survey says 30.7. Gee, didn't we say that as well? Didn't we say that 10 minutes was going to give us 30? Let's see, 10 minutes was supposed to give us 30 when we looked at the pretty picture. Well, the calculator's a little smarter, so it gets a little more accurate, but it's the same idea. Goodness, right? Graphs are a pretty good way to do formulas, right? Graphs are a wonderful way to do formulas, in fact. All right, so let's go back here. So let's try it for 40. What happens after 40 minutes? Isn't your coffee pretty much at room temperature by then? It's pretty much cooled off to the temperature of the room. Look at that. Sure enough. Sure enough, it is at 15 degrees and a bit. It's just above room temperature. Still, you can feel a little heat in it. All right, so now let's solve. So, you know how to solve by reading a graph backwards, but how do you solve using algebra? Well, you say, well, it's easy, right? I know the answer is 50, so I write it down. The only thing I don't know is that T. Yeah, that's easy. So I'm going to take away 15 off both sides. Yeah. Come on, this is easy, right? So I end up with that. Now I'm going to divide both sides by 80, of course. Yeah, we're whittling it down. So you'll end up with that, and then you go, oh, shoot. Now what do I do? What do I do when I get to here? Nobody ever taught me how to get an exponent out of the exponent place. I know how to get rid of numbers when they're multiplied, and I know how to get numbers that are added and subtracted by doing the opposite, and I know how to unsquare, and I know how to square root, but how do you unexponent? Oh my goodness, how do you do that? How do you undo an exponent? Well, you're going to use logarithms. What's a logarithm, you say? Very good question. All right, well, you know what? I don't know what a logarithm is, but I know what its picture looks like. Remember how to do an inverse function? Don't we want to do an undo? So the way you undo things, right? Remember doing it? Funny how we just learned this a couple of weeks ago. So you interchange the x for the y, and then you isolate the y by moving all the other stuff back to the other side, and we call that an inverse function. And in this case, for this particular function, 2x plus 4, so when you isolate stuff, right, swap the x's for y's, then pop all the other stuff to the other side, subtract 4, divide it all by 2. There you go. That's the inverse function. All right. And what does it look like when you graph it? Well, there you go. So this is old news. We've been doing this for a couple of weeks, right? We did this first unit. So it looks like this when you're done. Now, it might not look perfectly symmetrical because that's a rectangular grid instead of a square grid. So I should fix that up someday. But you get the idea. It's symmetrical across the diagonal. Look how those points exchange there. Look how a 0, 4 became a 4, 0. Look how a negative 2, 0 became a 0, negative 2. Look how a negative 4, negative 4 stayed an invariant negative 4, negative 4. All right, so that's definitely what we learned a couple weeks ago when we did transformations. All right, let's look at the inverse function of an exponent. There's a exponent, right? 4, 16. Right, a 4 gets you a 16 because 2 to the 4th is 16. Right, so we're doing the 2 to the x exponential function. So 2 to the 3 gets me 8. So of course, we're going to swap those around. So an 8 gets me 3 if I do the inverse function. So 8 gets me 3. Where'd she go? Oh, here she comes. So 8 gets me 3. So a 3 got me 8, so an 8 gets me 3. A 2 gets me 4, because a 2 squared is 4. Well, guess what a 4 gets me? A 4 gets me 2. I just swap the X's and the Y's. A 4 gets me 2. Well, look at this. A 1 gets me a 2 here. So that means a 2 gets me a 1 on my inverse function, because I just swapped the X's for the Y's. 1, 2, 2, 1. How about a 0? A 0 gets me 1. A 1 gets me 0. And look, what do you got down here? This is a negative 3 gets me a 1 eighth. So that means a 1 eighth right here. 1 eighth to the right gets me negative 3. So I think you see what's happening there. Right, this is going to come in asymptotically like this, and it's going to hug the y-axis. It's never going to actually touch it, by the way. Just like this never actually touched the x. It got down to an 8th, a 64th, a 128th, 1 part in 512. It got down as close as you like to 0, but it never did get to the x-axis. Just like this one, it never gets to the y-axis. All right, so we'll just read this. How did we do that? Well, in order to do that, we exchange the X's for the Y's. But again, we still have that problem. We can do it on the graph. We can see what the picture is. We can see what it does. We know exactly how to do it if we had a graph, but we don't have an equation to do it. So we just define away the problem. So we're going to define the inverse function of the exponential function. Hold on to your hats. Here we go. So here's what we say. We say, all right, let's do this. We're told if you have x equals 2 raised to the y, we define the variable y as follows. Therefore, y is the base 2 logarithm of x if x equals 2 raised to the y. Right, we'll just leave it like that for now. The way you say that is y is the base 2 logarithm, or the base 2 log, some people say, of x. So say that to yourself. Y is the base 2 logarithm of x. Y is the base 2 logarithm of x. So it turns out that this and this are saying the same thing. Because this says y is the exponent that you put on a 2 to get x. And this is saying, well, here's a 2 with an exponent of y on it, and you're getting x. This is taking some thinking. You want to sit in the tub with this one. Right? It's just like when we said x. If I said x squared is y, then you could say, well, x is the square root of y. So it's really just undoing it, all right? Not to confuse things. So if I said 3 is the base 2 logarithm of 8, then that means that 2 to the 3 is 8. All right, let's do some thinking there. Pause that if you want. See if you can think about this a bit more. Here we go. Next slide. All right, so this will always help you remember. A logarithm is an exponent. Say it to yourself now 20 times. A logarithm is an exponent. A logarithm is an exponent. A logarithm is an exponent. All right, so say it again later to yourself. A logarithm, if you say that to yourself 50 times over the next week, you will have exponents and logarithms aced. So thus, all right, consequently, the base 2 logarithm of 8 is the exponent that is necessary in order to write 8 as a power of 2. That is, namely, 3. Oh, crazy, eh? More generally, the base 2 logarithm of any number is the exponent necessary in order to write x as a power of 2. And who says we got to limit ourselves to a base of 2? You can do a base of anything. So let's call it base of b, b for base. So if I say y equals the base b logarithm of x, that's the exponent, because a logarithm is an exponent. A logarithm is an exponent. So y equals the base b logarithm of x is the exponent that is necessary in order to write x as a power of b, namely y. All right. So let's define the logarithm again, but this time we won't limit ourselves to a base 2. So if x is b to the y, then y is defined as the base b logarithm of x. Now there's some fine print that goes with that. Anytime you learn a formula, you know, there's some fine print, some tricks, some exclusions, some interpretations, you know. Like when you did Pythagoras, right? When you did Pythagoras, you had to know that the C was the long side, and they always forget to tell you that. So we'll save the fine print for a few minutes, all right? So see if you can digest this. Changing slides, ready, ready now. All right, this will help you out a bit. If I say express 5 to the 4th equals 625 in a logarithmic form, use a log. Well, you would say the base 5 log, because the base is a 5, the base 5 log of 625 is 4. Boom. Because the exponent, because a logarithm is an exponent, the exponent you'd put on a 5 to get a 625 is 4. Think. How about this one? Now I'm telling you the base 3 logarithm of 81 is 4. What does that mean if I was to put it in an exponential form? Well, doesn't it mean 3 to the 4th is 81? Because this says the exponent that you put on a 2 on a 3 to get 81 is 4. This says the exponent you put on a 3 to get an 81 is 4. So which means if you took a 3 and put an exponent of 4 on it, you should get 81. You see how we're thinking backwards here? Let's try this one. So that says 4 to the negative 3 equals 1/64th, which is the same as saying the base 4 logarithm of 1/64th is negative 3. Because the exponent you put on a 4 to get a 1/64th is negative 3. The base 3, oh, you're going to hate me for this one. The base 3 logarithm, the base 3 logarithm of 3 to the 5th. Have you got it? It's kind of stupid, actually. This says, this is the exponent, right? A log is an exponent. This is the exponent that you would put on a 3 to get 3 to the 5th. Do that again. This is an exponent. A log is an exponent. So this is the exponent you would put on a base of 3 so that you would get 3 to the 5th. So what is the exponent you put on a 3 to get 3 to the 5th? It's 5. Oh my goodness. Think about it. Exponent you put on a 3 to get 3 raised to the 5th is 5. It's tricky, eh? What is the base 6 logarithm of the square root of 6? Well, of course, it's smarter if you're going to be working with exponents to convert everything into exponents instead of those silly radicals. So I'd say it's 1/2. So let's rewrite this. If I say y is 2 to the x, you could say that means that x is base 2 logarithm of y. Well, you're probably pulling your hair out by now. Let's do this then. Let's go back and define the logarithm for the third time. But I'll put in all the fine print, all the codicils, all the gotchas. All right, so a logarithm is the inverse function. It undoes it. It doesn't undoes an exponent. So if I say y is the log base b of x, if and only if. So this only works if you got x equals b to the y. So when we're talking about an exponent like that, we can say that. And there's some codicils here, some little lawyer's rules. It turns out that only works if b is not equal to 0. So you can't have a base of 0. I mean, well, you could, but it'd be stupid. Why would you raise 0 to a number? You can't have a base of 1. Right? Why would you use a base of 1? 1 to the anything is 1. So you could have a base of 1, but you're wasting your time. And, oh, by the way, your b has to be more than 0. As we'll see later, it turns out you can't have a negative base, because then things go wonky. We'll see that later. And your x has to be more than 0. So it turns out you can't do a logarithm of a number that's less than 0. But you sort of saw that when we did the graph, didn't you? Did you notice that the graph for the logarithm, the domain was limited to the right side, to the quadrants 1 and 4. It never did go to the left side of the y-axis. So, yeah, we'll talk about that some more, too. But anyway, the fine print, you could probably survive without the fine print until, of course, you violate it. And then you'll go, why doesn't it work? Because you didn't read the fine print. All right, so the fine print's important. Not usually for me, because I won't try to trick you too often. All right, so it turns out that, don't forget, a logarithm is an exponent. So y is the exponent that is necessary in order to express y as a power of a. So the base a logarithm of y, the base a logarithm of y is the exponent that is necessary in order to give you y as a power of a. So it's the exponent you put on a to get y. So let's simplify this. If I said, what is the base 2 logarithm of 4 to the, whatever it is, x? What is the base 2 logarithm of 4 to the x? Well, you go, well, hold on, how do I do that? Well, here's a base of 2. How about if I turn that 4 into a 2? Then I got a base of 2 and a base of 2, and then maybe the bases of 2s will work in harmony and do something. So you end up going like this. So really you could say 4 is 2 squared. So then you could say, therefore, that's really saying the log of 2 raised to the 2x, because you could combine those by the power rule. So then you're going, so what is the exponent you put on a 2 to get 2 to the 2x? What's the exponent you put on a 2 to get 2 to the 2x? It's 2x. Oh, my goodness. Think about what you just said. Say it slowly. What is the exponent that you put on a 2 so that you get 2 raised to the 2x? Notice that they undo each other. A logarithm and an exponenting undo. So you just wipe those two out. There you go. You could just absolutely wipe them out. There. Won't you just wipe them out? The answer's 2x. Sweet. Next slide. This is where it'll all come home. All right, so let's go this way from left to right. So here's our function. Here's our exponent. Exponential function y is 4 to the x. So what's 4 to the negative 3? So 4 to the negative 3 is 1 over 4 to the positive 3. Sounds like 1 over 64. Bing. All right, what is 4 to the negative 2? Sounds like 1 over 16 to me. What's 4 to the negative 1? Well, that's 1 fourth. Now, this is where I ask you backwards. Now I ask you backwards. Now I say, if I want 1, 4 to the what would give me 1? What is the exponent I would put on 4 to get a 1? 4 to the what gives me 1? Well, 4 to the 0 gives me 1. There you go. You just did your first logarithm. Notice when you go that way, you're exponentiating. When you're going this way, you're logarithming, or whatever the word is. You're performing a logarithm when you go from right to left. Neat, eh? All right, let's go back to exponentiating. What is 4 to the 1 half? Well, it's really this. It's the square root of 4, it's 2. What is, so now if I say I've got a 4, what is the exponent I put on a 4 to get a 4? In other words, 4 to the what gave me 4? Well, it's 1, isn't it? 4 to the 1. How about 64? If I said, right, I gave it away there. If I say, what is the exponent that I would put on a 4 so I get 64? Well, you would go this way and say it's 3, because 4 to the 3 is 64. So the base 4 logarithm of 64 is 3. So when you're performing a logarithm, you're going that direction. The base 4 logarithm of 64 is 3. And the same thing here. 4 raised to the 4th is 256. All right, now we're working with a base of 7. 7 to the negative 2 is, hope you know it's 1 over 49 by now. Don't tell me that it's 0.02. You'll just make me ill. Seven. Let's see. What exponent do I need to put on a 7 so that I get 1 over 7? Well, the answer is negative 1. Here we go. That was easy. And I owed Brad a dollar for that one. How about this one? What exponent do I put on a 7? So what is the exponent that I put on a 7? What is the exponent I put on a 7? What is the x that I put on a 7 so that I get 7? Well, isn't it 1? So isn't the base 7 logarithm of 7 just 1? So the number that I... There it is. It's 1. So going to the right is exponentiating. Going to the left and unexponentiating is logarithming-ing-ing-ish. It's performing a logarithm. How's that? All right. Try these ones. There you go. So if you say 4 squared is 16, that's the same as telling me that the exponent that you put on a 4 to get a 16 is 2. Aren't I saying the exact same thing? Just backwards. 3 to the what is 8? 81. Well, 3 to the 4th is 81. Because the base 3 logarithm of 81 is 4. Well, you might want to rerun that slide too. This is really important stuff. Thinking backwards. Saying the same thing backwards is kind of fun. Try this one. Yeah, take some thinking to learn how to think backwards. All right, so remember how I said that sometimes a graph is... Actually, a graph is usually more than sufficient. In fact, sometimes there are things that you can't solve without a graph. Because remember, we didn't actually understand the logarithm until we graphed it. And then we figured out the formula that makes it. All right, so I just wanted you to estimate these things. Pretend you didn't know what a logarithm was. Pretend you didn't know what an exponent was. Pretend you were just... there are people that use charts all day long and haven't a clue what an exponent is. All right, I'm serious. I know lots of people that use charts and graphs all day long and they haven't a clue what an exponent or a logarithm is. Seriously. I'll show you here. All right, so knowing how to use a graph is... It's probably more important than knowing how to use a calculator, to be honest. Look, here's a graph on how to take off an airplane. Right? There's probably there is a really fancy formula on how to take off an airplane. It involves the temperature outside and how dense the air is and your elevation if you're up in the mountains or down at sea level. And it involves other things too, how heavy your airplane is and, you know, what your flap setting is. And there's about 4 different things that you got to do an equation for. Well, who the heck wants to do an equation? What you really do in real life is you do a graph. So you enter here with your temperature or something, and you go up to your weight, and then when you go to the weight of the airplane, and then you go across to the density of the air outside, what elevation you're at, you know, if you're up in Denver or down in sea level or something, and then you come down for, I don't know what this is, I can't read it, and Right, you come across, and then you go like that, and it tells you what you take off at that speed. So that's when the pilot pulls back on the yoke, and boom, the airplane takes off. A formula would do it, but who the heck wants to calculate a complicated formula when boom, 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 you could take a sharp pencil, and, you know, you could calculate the takeoff speed, give or take 2 miles an hour. Who cares if you're off by 2 miles an hour? Big deal. Right? So it turns out that reading a graph is actually more important than knowing how to use a calculator. Alright, so here let's have some after class fun. That was good. And then we did some that. We did some base 10. Oh, we did some more logs, right? I did a base 10 log, because you know what? You got a button on your calculator that does those. It's called the LOG button. Right? The base 10 logarithm of 100 is 2. So it's actually your log button on your calculator. So what's the base 10 log of 5? I think you'll find out it's pretty close to 0.7, because 10 to the 0.7 would be 5. Turns out this is really important if you're going to study electricity, right? Especially this 2. Right? That's when somebody says knock it down 3 dB. That's what they're saying. They mean knock the volume down by half. Well, and I was showing somebody here that adding exponents is really the same as multiplying, which is kind of how a slide rule works. And then somebody was messing around here. What were we doing with this? Oh, yeah, somebody was asking a question about these things, so we just mucked about there, and then I got a little crazy, and I realized something funny. I realized that 1 to the x is 1. I never thought of that before, believe it or not. I never realized that 1 raised to the anything is 1. Curious, eh? 1 raised to the anything is 1. Neat. I never thought of that before. And then Brad wanted to do that stuff. What was all that about? That was simultaneous linear equations, systems of equations. Did this in grade 11, substitution method. Right, isolate, plug into the other one. Boom, plug that in. Zip. A little bit of grade 9 math. Blah, blah, blah. End up with x equals -4. Plug that back into there so the y is +4. There you go. Or you could have done this elimination method. We skipped this in grade 11, actually, this elimination method, even though it was easier. So just double the first equation, subtract the second equation, the x's disappear, the y's become 5, boom, y equals 4, plug it back in, lots of plug-in, there you go, same answer. All right, well, that was just for Brad. All right, here we go. Briefing's complete. Okay, there's where we did, and we never, oh, so we never did do the trig, so tomorrow is radians for sure. So the quiz went really well, and briefing's complete.